spectral sensing applications.
Thanks, Alexandri, for the introduction, and thanks to Luis Filippi and the organizers for the opportunity to be here to present the work that we are doing at the IBM Research Lab in Brazil. So since some of you might not have heard about the IBM Research Lab in Brazil, I have a bit of information here, so to familiarize you with where we are and what we are doing. Some of you might be aware of the labs in the United States. Some of you might have been there in some way or form. The one where I started my career in IBM and did my postdoc is the T.J. Watson Lab, close to New York. And since 2010, we have a lab in Brazil, co-located in Rio de Janeiro and Sao Paulo. But also we have in the Southern Hemisphere labs in Africa and in Australia. And the idea here is that we bring the research into the emerging economies, have an industry focus, support the local economy and the local development. And in our case, here we have a focus on core and key industries for the Brazilian ecosystem, in our case, particular agriculture and oil and gas. So some of the research that we do is tailored and target for technology in those spaces, for those industries and application. And for our team, for my team, materials, novel materials, low dimensional materials play a part in this. So I'm going to show you how we use those materials as part of our effort to build new technology for those industries. And from IBM perspective as an IT company, we are talking oftentimes about what we call the IT stack. So in a way, that's this breakup that you are seeing here on the left hand side, that starts on the hardware level, on the chip level, starting actually at the scale where we do nanoscale science and technology, goes all the way from the hardware level into high-performance computing infrastructure. And then from data center infrastructure, we are able to provide services on top of the virtualizing layers and even analytics and data services on top. So in a way, innovation from IBM research perspective has to happen in all these different layers. And sometimes for some of the research projects we do, even in my team, we are spreading the research in and across different layers here. So I'll show you a few examples where we are trying to include new materials in order to build prototype technology that can be consumed as a hardware, as a lab on chip device, as much as a software simulation. So we can include some of the materials aspects that we are getting from lab experiments into software simulation that can be helpful for agriculture and oil and gas. So from a perspective of skills and expertise, that means also that for the teams, it's rather multidisciplinary effort. So I'm a physicist, physical chemist by training, but we also have engineers, computer scientists working together in our team, because typically one particular discipline doesn't have all the skills and experience available in order to connect through these different layers in order to put a prototype together that could actually function and being tested in a particular application. When it comes to IBM M research, I think there's another video in here that starts when I click twice. From our team's perspective, we believe that our niche is in the gap between academic fundamental research and the industry. So in particular here in Brazil, there is certainly a need for more research and scientific as much as development efforts for industrial applications. So in that sense, we are trying to bridge the gap between the fundamental sciences that we are seeing in academia at the universities. We have collaborations with universities here in Brazil. and work with the universities in order to do fundamental science work. At the same time, we work with industry clients, with research interested parties in the industry that are interested in seeing how we can connect the dots, how we can leverage the fundamental science included into a technology prototype and leverage that and field test it in the industry. So our niche is this. And one particular focus of our team is in the area of micro and nanofluidics, because in agriculture and oil and gas, particular natural resources management, a lot of the problems that we are seeing today are related to incomplete recovery of natural resources. So oftentimes, like in our terms, in our language, the liquid-solid interactions are the interactions that are not fully and completely understood in order to devise a strategy to recover natural resources in the most efficient and most economic and least harmful way in terms of the environment. So with regards to the location, in case you get a chance to visit, we are located in, and that is true for most part of my team, in the Pasteur, Avenida Pasteur in Rio de Janeiro. So you can see the IBM buildings in Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro, where we have the lab. And a particular differentiator for my team is the fact that we actually have a physical lab space available in which we can do actual device work, materials characterization, nano and micro scale, doing prototyping of devices. So it's relatively small lab. Possibly that's why we call it the nano lab. No, I'm just kidding. It's more because of the experimental techniques that we are using there. So its footprint is relatively limited, but we have highly integrated measurement techniques and characterization techniques available that allow us to do some of the research that I'm going to show you in a little bit. And I think for us the most important part in this lab is that we are able to make some devices, but not all of the devices that I'm going to show you were made here. We can leverage manufacturing capabilities in other IBM labs. So we have collaborations with the TJ Watson lab, for example, where we can take advantage of a research fabrication line that allows us to do 200 millimeter CMOS integration. So these are things that we don't have available here, but we can use the facilities there, do device work, and actually measure and characterize and customize and design the samples here at this lab. So just to give an impression of what is possible here for us. On top of that, we are able to establish some IoT connectivity, use cloud infrastructure. So in case we want to hook up a sensor, connect devices and test how they operate as a part of an enterprise technology platform, that is something that is also very interesting for the students that are very interested working with us in an internship, for example. We have an internship model. I'm going to talk a little bit later about that, that allows us to have interns from the university working with us for up to 2 years, and my team has taken advantage of that opportunity quite a lot. So with regards to the nano lab, was a substantial investment that the company did in order to put us in a position to do actual physical science in terms of experimental work. And one example of let's say a chip that we can build here in Brazil is not containing 2D materials. Just to give you an example of what it is a paper-based chemical sensor that has colorimetric indicators in it that allows us to do chemical testing in an agriculture application. So here, for example, we have pH, nitrogen dioxide, aluminum, magnesium, chlorine. And we have a smartphone application that you can use in order to read that test and returns the result to you. And we are actually field testing that type of technology. So we are always looking for ways of taking the prototypes to the field, testing for a particular industrial application. And who knows, maybe one day we have 2D materials included in such a device. So with regards to the team, I mentioned before, we have many research interns from universities working with us. For us, it's very important to have academic collaborations across physical science, computer science, material science, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering. So we have been very active, and these kind of collaborations are very, very good for the interns and research interns. We can have the research interns on all levels. We had undergraduate students, we have master students, we have PhD level students coming, working with us, and I think for them it's a great experience, if you will, because the working mode and the focus of what we do is a bit different of what typically they experience at the universities. So it's just something that I want to advertise to you in case you see some interesting opportunities for your students, and you might have colleagues in Rio de Janeiro teaching there. Please let them know. We are always looking. So now for the greater part of the presentation, when I'm actually going to talk about what relates to this workshop, which is 2D materials, I'm going to use the word platform a lot. So in that sense, what I mean by that is that we are looking into a substrate that could be used for semiconductor processing in a way that we could do steps for larger scale integration. CMOS compatible processes is an example that we are using here for those of you that are more interested in the technology aspects of the material processing. And these kind of technologies and manufacturing processes can be helpful. The typical examples that you also know from academia, if we have new materials, we typically build field effect transistors, PIN diodes, photodetectors, light emitters, and such. In our team, for the fact that we do a lot of these liquid-solid, liquid-liquid interaction works, we also use 2D materials for novel sensors and lab-on-chip on devices. So some of the examples that I will show to you might look a bit strange from the perspective that they don't belong into the group of photodetectors and transistors that we're typically interested in communication devices. But we believe, due to the surface-to-volume ratio that the materials have, they allow to integrate functionalities that bulk semiconductors cannot typically provide. So it's a good opportunity to check if those materials can be used in novel lab-on-chip technologies. So my cutoff in time is 2013, which was the year when I moved from the United States to Brazil. So that coincided with first work that we did still in TJ Watson in collaboration with our partners at Cambridge University in the United Kingdom. And in that, that was our first experience with using not graphene and carbon nanotubes for doing the type of device work that we were doing at that time, which is essentially building light emitters, light detectors, including those materials into cavities in order to tailor and customize the light matter interactions. So here was the first time that we used molybdenum disulfide, and in fact was kind of failed effort, because what we did here is we had a we call that a platform tool. It was, can think of it as a microscope slide that you use in immersion optical microscopy. So it's a 170 micrometer thick glass slide, and we had a process developed in order to manufacture devices on top of that very brittle, very thin microscope slide that would have the advantage that we could apply high-resolution optical microscopy from the underside of the sample. We could contact the device from the top. So experimentally, it has a lot of benefits. So you have some control about the electronic properties of the device. At the same time, you can raster scan the sample and have optical resolution of below micrometer scale, let's say 250, 300 nanometer resolution. And you can map out the device, and you can collect the light from the sample with very high efficiency. So we built that thing in order to build a split gate diode. So we wanted to build a PIN diode However, the split gates that are sitting on top here, this chromium gold electrodes on top, they were not good enough in order to change the band structure of the device in a way that we could create an actual PIN junction. So what we had to do is we had to run a very high current among the two contacts of the molybdenum disulfide, so to heat up the material and actually use a less efficient process in order to generate light. But since the substrate is glass and the material is optically transparent, it gives us a lot of opportunity to study all kinds of optical signals, so we can measure absorption and electroluminescence, photoluminescence on the same sample. And because the collection efficiency in this immersion microscopy is so high, we are able to collect the electroluminescence from 2D material, 2D semiconductor for the first time, because the process here that we had to apply was very inefficient. And since the split gate PIN junction didn't work, we had to rely on that process. However, it was the first time, so a failed experiment, made it for a paper, and we are happy that we had it, because it was still the first, even though a lot of groups at the same time were working on that. And just 1 year later, I think those back-to-back papers in one issue of Nature Nanotechnology came out, where people actually succeeded in building, creating split gate diodes with these materials, not with molybdenum disulfide, but tungsten diselenide in that case. And that seemed to be a better behaved material in order to do the job. So this is actual device work that has been continuing in that domain. And besides molybdenum disulfide and tungsten diselenide, there has been a plenitude of material that at that amount, in that time range, appeared on the scene, and people start using all kinds of different materials for optoelectronic applications. And that's because all these layered materials, I think we saw that chart yesterday already in one of the presentations, all these different layered materials, they can be used for different purposes, because their band gap or their exciton energies, they depend on the particular materials. In some cases, they depend on the layer stack thickness. So in that sense, from a photonics or optoelectronics standpoint, is interesting that you could go, you have a catalog, you pick, okay, where do I want my emission energy, where do I want my absorption energy to occur? You take the material, you exfoliate it, you build a device, and you can study it. So that, in theory, is the plan. And the first thing that we did after molybdenum disulfide was looking at a material that at that time became interesting enough for the community, black phosphorus, because here it seemed the band gap of the material depended on the thickness, on the layer thickness. So depending on the amount of layers in the stack, you would see that the gap, the band gap of the material would change accordingly to the layer number. So that is interesting in the sense that you could design from the same material, depending on the number of layers that you have, a material that detects in a particular spectral range. What we were interested in was in particular to extend the spectral range for a silicon photodetector, as you know, has a limit when it comes to detecting outside the visible spectral range. If you go to the infrared at some point, the band gap of silicon will preclude that you see in the telecommunications window. So that's why it could be interesting to use black phosphorus, for example, in order to build an imager, a photodetector that allows you to see images where silicon photodiode could not see it. So we thought it would be a nice extension and a nice application for hyperspectral imaging. So we got this material, and we built a device that we characterize by photocurrent microscopy. So that's typically a step that you do before deploying that type of sensor or device for a particular application. and the device showed a strong photo response in the visible range in the IR spectral regime. So we had a laser, we would shine the laser on the device, raster scan the device, and we would see photocurrent coming from the device and the illumination in both spectral ranges that we were interested in. So that was a good start. The next step was actually to use that device that we characterized, deploy it in the detection plane of a confocal microscope. So we built a microscope just to host that device, and we used another microscope in order to shine a laser on a test structure so that we could create an image that we would pick up with that particular black phosphorus device. So the idea here is we shine laser light on a metallic structure, and we can define the resolution of the metallic structure and then scan the sample and collect the light with this black phosphorus photodetector. So here is the result. On the left-hand side, you see these are possibly SEM images of the test pattern that we have made. These are squares made of gold. The upper one is 4 micrometer side length. The middle one is 2 micrometer side length, and the lower one is 1 micrometer side length. And what you see on the right-hand side are the optical images that we took by using this black phosphorus photodetector. And you see that the resolution, as expected, depends on the wavelength that we are using, because when the wavelength of the illuminating light source, if that wavelength of that light source comes into the range of the resolution of the features that we are imaging, we would expect that image to blur, and that's what we are seeing. So for 532 nanometers, we are able to resolve very clearly the structures, while for 1550 nanometer infrared illumination, for the smallest features, we are seeing some blurring of the images. So next test pattern that we made in order for studying the image formation process a bit better were this IBM logo sample, where we had structures in X and Y with a certain pitch, so a certain distance between the metal features. And now we could perform simulations and experiments in order to understand, given the wavelength and the microscope features, what is the kind of image that we would expect. And we get decent agreement between the simulation results and our experiments. And that was a very good result for us, because we realized black phosphorus would have the advantage of being able to see an image where a silicon photodiode would not be able to see an image. And I thought, and we thought, that would be a nice addition for what 2D materials could bring to the table in terms of optoelectronic devices. So another question that arises at about the same time is that BP, black phosphorus as a material, was hard to handle in terms of manufacturing, because exposed to air, it's rather not well behaved, it's rather unstable. So there's a lot of attracted a lot of interest, because the material looked very promising in terms of optoelectronics applications, but it was very hard to manufacture. So if the material was exposed to atmosphere, to the air for too long, it would drag water, it would decompose relatively quickly, and a lot of folks got into studying the material, the exposure to ambient conditions, and we thought we could apply a method that we had previously applied to graphene and carbon nanotubes, which is a method to study the in situ temperature distribution in a functioning black phosphorus transistor if you pass an electrical current through it. So that material, as we can study it at the same time when we pass an electrical current through it, heats up, and as more as the current heats up the material, would expect that the material also at some point becomes unstable and would eventually break up, because typically high-performance electronics will heat up to a certain point, and then the material will break, and you will be able to see that in the device, in the electronic device performance, by not being able to control the device. You're not going to be able to pass a current anymore. We knew from our past experience that graphene, carbon nanotubes, those devices, they would break close to the contact in an area where the heating was particularly strong. And we wanted to see if we could apply that same method in order to study how the black phosphorus device heats when we pass an electrical current. So the method for that, or one method of choice for that, is Raman spectroscopy. Raman spectroscopy has the benefit that we can see individual vibrations of the material, and if we do the job right, it's possible for us to see Stokes and anti-Stokes signal from the material in the spectroscopy. So here's an example, and if we can monitor for a particular current level, those two phonon modes, we can compare the areas that are related to the intensities of those peaks. We can integrate the areas for Stokes and anti-Stokes signals, and then calculate the effective phonon temperature. So that is a method that worked very well, as I said, in carbon-based materials, and we thought, okay, let's try if it works for black phosphorus. We applied this method. We passed a current through this black phosphorus device. Here you see the different bias points, so we would apply a certain voltage. We would establish a certain current level. As soon as the current level is stable, we would perform the Raman spectroscopy in order to get the Stokes anti-Stokes signal and then calculate a particular phonon temperature from that result. What we could also see is that not only the intensity ratios were changing as a function of the electrical current, also the Raman modes were shifting, so we were also able to extract the Raman shifts as a function of the electrical power for the different phonons that we were able to see in the Raman spectroscopy. So in terms of results, we can now calibrate the Stokes anti-Stokes ratio and extract those temperatures, and we see that they fairly well coincide for the principal phonon modes of the material. So this is plotted here in terms of the Stokes anti-Stokes ratios that are relatively well behaved, almost a linear dependency on injected electrical power. So here we see the power density in the device, and you see that the anti-Stokes-Stokes ratios in these principal phonon modes follow a more or less linear relationship until the breaking point. So we actually extended the experiment until the device was no more. At some point, the device actually breaks, it snaps, and afterwards we took the device to the SEM, and here you can actually see this device broken after we passed a current of the order of 35 milliwatts through the device. So that would relate to a temperature of about 800 degrees Celsius. So until 600 degree Kelvin, we were able to have reliable device performance. Past that, we see that a practical device would possibly heat up too much and fail. And that is an interesting information for those who are interested in manufacturing devices, electronic devices, and understand what are those performance limits of transistors made of these materials. So now, switching gear again a little bit, coming to work on heterostructure, so moving forward in time at about a little bit later than 2015, we started looking into heterostructures here. At that time, main focus was on studying the excitons, so bound electron hole pairs, for their optical behavior in the overlap region is of particular interest from a fundamental perspective. We had those structures, and they were very interested for the fact that in some of these materials that we are having here, tungsten diselenide, molybdenum diselenide, the optical signal, the photoluminescent signal, is very strong. That is a great advantage for optical spectroscopists like myself, so we can use some of the techniques that we have very well for these materials and study effects that are relatively weak even at room temperature, because the microscopy and the spectroscopy works very well. So we have chosen to do a particular study of the field dependency with this material because it fits very well to the detection range of the instruments that we have. So we have decided to look into one piece of that heterostructure that contains only a single layer of molybdenum diselenide. So here you see the photoluminescence band, you see a Raman spectrum that helps us to characterize the material. We also performed an AFM measurement in order to confirm the thickness of the single layer material. And this material we wanted to use to study, as I said, because the photoluminescent signal is very strong, can be easily detected with our setup, and we wanted to study if we can see any field dependence, electric field dependence at room temperature. So the expectation here would be that the exciton formation, we heard yesterday about the formation of excitons in those materials, strongly bound electron hole pairs in two dimensions, that if they are exposed to a field, they have the tendency to dissociate. So here, from past experiments in solid state and condensed matter physics, we know that if materials are confined, a particular perpendicular field condition could lead to a very strong shift and very strong dissociation effect. So our hope was that if we would apply a field in that structure, that we would see some modulation or shift of that photoluminescence peak. And in fact, by applying a field, we see that the intensity of the photoluminescence peak is modulated. Even let's say, relatively weak fields, we see a reproducible and noticeable modulation, which was a good starting point, because we could see that at room temperature, and we did not need to cool the sample to liquid helium temperature. So it was a very good result for us. So next was the analysis of the spectral shape. So we saw a very small but significant shift of the emission energy that is consistent with the quadratic fit. That is what we would expect in terms of a stark shift. Also, we see a broadening of the homogeneous line width of the photoluminescence band, which supports in its size and in its shape, the notion of dissociation occurring as we increase the electrical field. So the exciton experiences an external field, it gets dragged in one direction, and this dissociation of, or this onset of dissociation, leads to opening an yet another relaxation channel for the excited state, and that's what we are seeing here in change of the line width and also in the change of the intensity signal, because the radiative decay gets less likely because the dissociation as a non-radiative effect gets more pronounced. So now looking at the time domain, we would expect that the fluorescence excited state decay that represents the average lifetime of the excited state would show that tendency as well, and indeed it does. So if we apply the field and we measure the excited state decay directly in the time domain, we see a modulation of the excited state decay time of the order of 40 picoseconds for the moderate fields that we are able to apply in that experiment. So that supports, in addition to the line width broadening, the notion that we are actually looking at the dissociation of the exciton in molybdenum diselenide. So if you finally compare the lifetime shortening with the broadening of the homogeneous line width, it looks like a constant in the range that we are observing. That would be kind of the expectation. So any reduction in lifetime should equally lead to a broadening of the homogeneous line width. But it's far above of what we would consider the fundamental limit, just because at room temperature the homogeneous line width is very broad. So in that sense, only cooling to lower temperatures would get us closer to the ultimate limit here. And another thing that's plotted here on the right-hand side is some extrapolations that could be useful for folks that are interested to build light emitters or light modulators and all kinds of technologies based on these materials. So these extrapolations could be used in order to understand the configuration and the devices that are needed in order to build a functioning technology that could do a job, let's say, for example, in amplification of pulse signals or in multiplexing, in light photonics application, and so on. Another thing that we are interested in is to look at the time response of an actual photodetector directly. So here we looked at the time response of the photoluminescent signal. So we illuminate with a short laser pulse, we collect the fluorescence photons from the exciton recombination, and we correlate the signal. This is the lifetime that we are measuring. It would be interesting to see what we get if we send those short pulses to the device and look at the correlation of the electronic pulses that we are getting in order to understand the time response. So if we can actually build a device that could operate at gigahertz or below nanosecond regimes, which would be the necessity if you wanted to have something that we would call a fast optical device. But that is that's nothing that we have and share right now.
Can I ask a question? So do you know what is the relaxation mechanism of the exciton? Do you know how it relaxes?
It's very complicated, in particular at room temperature. It's more complicated. It seems there is a decay bottleneck. So what is understood so far is that there exist two decay components. One is ultra fast, one is slower. So there are intermediate states involved, and the radiative decay that we see here reflects that, because the decay profile that I showed before is essentially multi-exponential. So this is a semi-logarithmic plot. If it was a straightforward radiative decay process, you would expect a mono-exponential decay. So from the fact that you see a multi-exponential decay here, you see the complexity of the internal relaxation pathway. We know there are several competing mechanisms to the radiative decay, and dissociation, the one that we open, is just one of them. But it's a complex, ongoing research in itself. Okay. So now switching gears completely, moving from optoelectronic devices into a measurement that fits a bit to the industrial research that I was talking about in the beginning, in the introduction of my presentation. For some of the microfluidics or nanofluidics measurements that we would like to do for industrial application in oil and gas recovery, for example, it would be interesting if we were able to monitor the flow of particle in a microfluidic device. Typically, when you do velocimetry measurements, if you inject a liquid into a complex micromodel in a microfluidic chip, you can track single particles, and you do that by tracking the fluorescence trace of those particles along with the flow in the device. So typically you require a transparent device, optically transparent device. You monitor the signature of particles flowing, and from successive frames and images, you are able to extract the trajectory and also the flow profile within the device. So for some of the applications that we are after, this is a very, very important application that we need for lab testing. And one idea was why we cannot use 2D materials in order to do an all-electronic measurement. That means we don't want to use the optical fluorescence measurement to track the trajectory of the particles, but is it possible to track electronically, for example, by the means of graphene? So here we have performed it's an all simulation work, so we don't have an experimental implementation. But the team has used the process steps that we know can be integrated and implemented from devices that we typically do, and try to include that into the simulation. So we have made a simulation of the device performance based on the assumptions that are taken from CMOS integration. So what we came up with is a device stack that includes various metal lines that are able to produce a particular magnetic field that allows us to use a Hall bar based on graphene in order to track magnetic nanoparticles. So we did that study in order to being able to track a particle along a microfluidic channel or nanofluidic channel in a device of sorts. So you see the same particle in red going along the device channel, and based on which sensor cell it passes, so we have different cells here in each sensor, in each hall bar, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, depending on where the device passes, the hall voltage that we receive from the device should lead to spatial differentiation. So what we are hoping is to look at all these different voltage signals that we are getting as the magnetic particle passes with the flow, and then being able to reconstruct with triangulation algorithms the position from these voltage signals that I actually have here on the slide. So in that very, very simple implementation, we have 3 × 3 pixels here as part of this. But of course, in a larger scale, you could expand that to n × n pixels. So it depends on the complexity of the integration and the size of the graphene that you have available. That is the main limit of any practical application of this. But the idea is to follow the particle based on the voltage signal, and here is a simulation of how that would look like. So based on the, let's say, all the ingredients for the material parameters that we use in the process of making that device, here is what we would simulate as a voltage. And we also did the reverse. So one researcher created a trajectory and simulated the voltages, and another researcher had the task to reconstruct the trajectory. And in that way, we could establish that, at least from a very fundamental point of view, the principle would work out okay. So this kind of technique could allow to do a non-optical flow sensing, non-optical flow characterization, which would mean you don't need to have a lab microscope, a fluorescence measurement setup, but you could connect your system to an electronic interface and being able to do this particle tracking electronically. Another example of that kind of sensing technology that is a bit different from what we are typically seeing is also related to liquid and liquid-solid interactions, is this chip that we came up with. It's also built on a transparent microscope slide, as you can see here. That's this cover slip, and contains an array of graphene sensor devices. I think we have one example here, integrated at the surface, that allows to perform different tasks. So you could either pass a current through that graphene layer and heat liquid that is deposited on top. You could use that as a liquid sensor. And you can integrate it in a way that you can modify the surface. You could include certain structures and surface patterns or functionalizations that allow you to study the effect that the surface has on the wetting properties of any material. In our case, the most important interaction that we are studying is oil on rock, and rock being represented by sandstone, for example, carbonate. Those are the surfaces that we would like to have in order to understand what is the adsorption, the adhesion energy of the liquid at the surface, so that we can devise certain structures such as moieties, EOR, we call that EOR molecules, enhanced oil recovery molecules, that could be surfactants, polymers, that could help us to remove some of that oil that resides at the surface from the surface. And one particular problem that we are seeing is that the size of the droplet will change the physics of that kind of interaction. But I'm going to come back to that. So step by step, the first step that we did to use that device was in order to ensure basic functionalities, do some electrical and optical test measurements. So we deposited different liquids on top of that of one of these graphene devices in the ray that you are seeing here. The device has an integrated backgate, a transparent ITO electrode. So what you're seeing on the right-hand side is a gate sweep with different liquids on top, and the different polarities of the liquids lead to different interactions with the graphene layer. So if we sweep the back gate, we see that if we have it in air, if we have it underwater or under test oil decane, we see that the gate characteristic changes very strongly. That is not a big surprise, and possibly also not sufficient in order to establish the chemical identity. So in that sense, we have applied to the same liquids Raman spectroscopy, because that gives us the chemical fingerprint of the material. So in that sense, what you're seeing here in the lower right-hand side are the corresponding Raman spectra that we can use to identify and differentiate between, let's say, water and decane deposited on top of the device. Because if you look visually, you cannot distinguish between the liquids. They pretty much look the same. But with the Raman spectroscopy or with an electronically calibrated measurement, you would be able to distinguish. So that was the first step. Then, of course, it's interesting to see if there's any sort of time resolution to this. So depositing water is a good way to check that, because the water droplets evaporate so quickly, they hit the material, and you see that the wetting properties are pushing the material away. At the same time, the material evaporates very quickly. So you see this dynamic in the transport characteristics. So you set to a certain bias point, you have a straight line current, you deposit the droplet, and it starts to wiggle and reflect all those dynamics that you are seeing in the picture. So in principle, the peak or the time resolution here is in the regime of milliseconds, or let's say hundreds of milliseconds to be specific, but could be higher. That depends a bit on the measurement system that we are using. So finally, because that was important for our application of this chip, wanted to study very small droplets and see if it's possible to collect a topography. So we used a oil emulsion that allows us to actually apply an AFM measurement on top across the droplets that are residing at the surface of that chip and correlate them with an optical signal. So now we are able to see the topography and also the optical image of the same spatially isolated emulsion droplets in that chip. And these droplets can be very small. They can be attolitter small. So to give you a size dimension for that, these are droplets, Sessel droplets, with diameters of less than a micrometer. Can be much smaller than that. And that was something that we were actually interested in, to find the ultimate limits of what small means small in a droplet. And here we were now for the first time able to see droplets that have, they are so small that we can model them directly with molecular dynamics and coarse-grain molecular dynamics simulation. So what you are seeing here is a droplet that contains possibly a few hundred thousand coarse-grained decane molecules, and we can compare that directly with an AFM measurement that we get in order to calibrate the shape in order to extract the adsorption energy. As I mentioned in the introduction of this particular work, what were interesting for us to understand how the size of the droplet and the volume of the droplet determines the adsorption energy. Because in an oil reservoir, for example, the droplets and the oil resides in very small capillary networks. So it's important to understand what is the interaction energy that those oil droplets or oil inclusions have in those small capillaries. So we did some studies with regards to that, so that we can take these kind of results and plug them into some of the flow simulations that we are doing, so that they can be consumed as a part of a software model. So now, switching gear for the last time. How much time do I have left? Okay, that should be enough. It's related to actual device manufacturing. And for some of you who might know this bottom-up nanoparticle integration, for you it's a clear problem that we are having in the community for a long time, that it's difficult to take nanomaterials such as nanotube, quantum dots, 2D materials from the solution and locate them at a substrate, at a wafer surface, for example, at positions and with orientations that we predefine. That is very, very, very difficult problem, has limited our ability to do a lot of upscaling with nanoscale electronics. So one method that was used in the past in order to predetermine the position for what we call the assembly or the placement of the nanomaterials from solution is a method called dielectrophoresis. So here you apply electric AC field between two deposition electrodes, metal electrodes, and if you adjust the electric field conditions properly, you are able to drag the material from the solution to the position between the electrodes. So that's a material deposition method that was used for making nanotube devices at larger scale. And we thought, why not using graphene electrodes to do the same thing? Because we have experienced that these metallic electrodes that we use for the assembly can deteriorate the device performance. We did some high frequency studies on those transistors, and if you have these metal lines, they will typically deteriorate the performance. So it would be good if we could remove the deposition electrodes, but the metal electrodes, they are very hard to get rid of. So if you want to make devices and you want to get rid of these electrodes, very hard thing to do. So we thought graphene would be nice. It's better material. It's like the ideally flat two-dimensional deposition electrode, and it could be removed with a very gentle etching step. So why not trying this? So the vision is to use larger area graphene layers, etch them into structures that predefine the position for the assembly, apply the field, and then do the assembly. So here's an electrostatic field study that compares the typically 30 nanometer high metallic electrode that we use in a assembly for doing those solution-driven processes with a graphene electrode. So as you might remember from the black phosphorus device, I mentioned that before, the devices typically break close to the contact. So the closer we get the contact to resemble something like a flat layer, the better it is for the actual device performance. And here are some examples. So on the left-hand side, you see the in principle. On the right-hand side, you see an actual SEM image of the test structures we made. And here is what we get, a nanotube solution. We use a nanotube solution because it is nice to measure if we get some alignment of the nanotubes. And I don't know if the contrast is sufficient to see the nanotubes are, in fact, aligned within a few degrees with respect to each other in parallel, and they bridge the gap between the two graphene electrodes here and here with a pitch of the order of 50 per micron. So afterwards, we can use a gentle etching step in order to remove the graphene. So we are having the graphene removed and the nanotubes stay in place, and we can now do that in all kinds of configurations. So we see these finger electrodes, the nanotubes are only assembled at the position where we have the graphene electrodes. When the field is applied, afterwards we can remove and build electronic devices that also works with two-dimensional materials from solution. Here we have a thin film device assembled from molybdenum disulfide, which is spatially isolated in solution, so similar to nanotube suspension, and works the same way. And in the upper images, you can see that by choosing the assembly voltages and the voltage parameters, you are able to determine and adjust a bit the density of the assembly that you are getting. So we have not studied individual nanotube or individual nanosheet assembly yet. So we have focused on thin film devices here, but it could be an interesting piece of research, because with metal electrodes, it was already shown it's possible to create a single nanotube deposition condition. So why not also with graphene electrodes? And finally, also a thin film of one. I mean, now we have zero-dimensional materials in a way, quantum dot placement. This is just to show it doesn't actually matter which type of material you have in the solution. can be a 1D, a 0D, or a 2D semiconductor. You can assemble a thin film device and make it into an electronic device, as you can see from the transport characteristics. And just to conclude, so here for those of you experts in device manufacturing, a more advanced device that we would use for making high frequency devices that have an embedded gate electrode. And we have made these structures at larger scale, at wafer scale, and then deposited the graphene and etched the graphene so that we would deposit the nanotubes across that buried gate electrode. So that would then bring us the alignment, and afterwards we would finalize this device with the metal step. So here you see the assembly of the nanotubes across that buried gate electrode, and here the final device with two metal electrodes on top. And it was possible now to scale that here to a gate length of 40 nanometer, which is already quite decent. It's not the ultimate limit, but already, from our perspective, a scaled device. And more importantly, a larger scale integration, because the whole point of this was not only to do one device where we exfoliate and you know make all the contacts and leads depending on the position of that flake, but where we predefine the position of, let's say, thousands or even millions of devices, and that's what we are seeing here. So we did larger arrays of those graphene layers that had those embedded gate structures at many, many different positions. So we can make like thousands or millions of those devices in one shot in the same deposition as part of a larger scale integration process. And here you can see so that you can see that the process is working end to end, a few transport characteristics of the nanotube array transistors to show that they are actually functioning. So the last question here was, so how complete is actually this assembly? Because from a yield perspective in manufacturing, the most important part is how complete is that assembly? Do you have it only at a few sites, or do you have it in the entire area where you wanted to have it? So we counted now the assemblies of many, many different deposition sites, so these are more than 1,000 sites, and in these subcells we get a yield of 97%, which is quite decent from a manufacturing perspective, which means that if we apply the voltage once to these graphene patterns, we get the desired assembly in 97% of cases at an area of sorts of the order of millimeter square. So we have an area of millimeter square where we can do nanoscale assemblies that have a resolution of 40 nanometer, just to put that in a perspective. It's already a good integration density. And with that, I'm out of time, and also at the end of my presentation, just wanted to acknowledge here some of the collaborating teams that we have been working with over the years. So it's also UFMIG is on the slide here. Ado Jorio is not here today. He was also instrumental, was the first collaboration agreement that we were able to strike with the Federal University from IBM here in Brazil, and also other groups from Germany, from the United States, and from the UK that some of you might know. So with that, thanks again for your time and your patience, and in case you have any questions, please feel free to ask. Thank you.
Any questions? So I have a question. In the case of the electrophoresis for the quantum dots,
yeah,
do you actually manage to get a single quantum dot inside the nanogap, or is a kind of a array of quantum dots all connected?
In the work, we did not try specifically to do that. What we were